Okay, we are recording. I am going again to mention this. This document is there on my web page. I have requested you to study it. We are not looking at all of it. Harmonic balance, mm-hmm. you have seen. These curves you have seen from the continuation method. So harmonics and subharmonics, mm-hmm. I will just leave it to you to study this section. It is interesting to me, but I don't have time to really cover all those. This is an important problem. I hope you will see this one. See, this is an oscillator. It's a nonlinear oscillator. It is forced at sine 60 and x equals minus sine 2t is an exact solution. Okay. So you see, this is a nonlinear system with external forcing where the response can be at a different frequency. Even with some damping and things like that, such solutions are there. Okay. Then limit cycles, we have seen just a little bit. We have seen the averaging of that. Entrainment is what I'm going to do now. Okay. So this is section 9. This is the first part of today's lecture or today's meeting. So we have the Van der Pol equation, which we have studied like this. Now I can actually use my pen and mark it because it won't matter later. So this is the Van der Pol oscillator, the basic oscillator. Now what I have done is I have just imagined that it is slightly detuned so that the time period of the oscillation is not 2 pi, but a little bit different. Okay. When I do that, then if I do averaging, with, you know, a sine phi or a sine t plus phi or a cos t plus phi, I'll get this kind of relation. This you are used to, this you have seen. Phi dot we had got zero, that is because delta was previously zero. This is the detuning, okay? So, but now, if I take this detuned oscillator and force it with f sine t, what happens? So what is this? This is a Van der Pol oscillator with periodic forcing at a frequency slightly different from that of the unforced limit cycle. Okay. Now you may imagine that if f is very big, then delta will be overwhelmed and the oscillator will respond at this frequency. And if f is very small, then f will be overwhelmed and the oscillator will oscillate at its preferred frequency where phi dot will be drifting slowly. And in between, there may be a contest between them. Okay, so then when we do the averaging, which I am not going to do here, this is this phenomena where this frequency gets locked to that frequency. This is called entrainment. Okay, so how many of you are aware that people who are put in caves with artificial lighting, they tend to go to a sleep cycle of 25 hours rather than 24 hours, typically. Have you heard this? Anybody?
No, sir.
Okay, so you can look it up. Our normal sleep-wake cycle is a little longer than 24 hours. So when people are put inside, artificial environments where they turn on light and turn off light and they don't know whether outside it is day or night, they go to a cycle that is a little bit different from 24 hours and typically closer to about 25 hours. But when we come out, then the external forcing of the sun and day and night entrains us to the 24-hour cycle. You see? So
is that because we are lazy?
No, it is some aspect of evolution. I don't know whether the fact that it is close to 24 hours is quite interesting.
Okay.
Laziness would mean that if you put someone in a room with no work, then he sleeps 16 hours a day. That is laziness. But the 24-hour or 25-hour cycle, I don't think is directly connected to laziness.
Not laziness, close to it.
I don't even see how it is close to it. See, laziness has to do with willingness to do work or not willingness to do work. Now, if you live for 70 years, then you will sleep many times. So the cycle of sleep is, I think, related to other things. Let's not get distracted by that anyway. It is an unanswerable cultural question with value judgment implicit in it. Okay. So let's not go there. But let's come here. These are the averaged equations. Now, I had done this with A and phi, but I realized that it is better to do it in polar coordinates. Okay. So I can think of this A and phi. I can think of the amplitude as being this radial coordinate. I can think of this as some phi like this in some phase space. Then I can convert it to C and D. You see? So A sine T plus phi, I write A cos phi, A sine phi. So I have C and D. When I write the equations in terms of C and D, these same equations, then they come out to be this. And it is a little difficult to understand where the entrainment is, but in the CD phase space, they are very clear. So here I have taken delta equal to 1, F is equal to 0. Epsilon has gone away, right? Because epsilon just appears here. We are only doing first order averaging in several problems recently. So epsilon just adjusts the speed with which the phase portrait is drawn, you see, but the shape of the phase portrait does not matter. In that, there is this free parameter delta and this free parameter F, nothing else. I hope you all agree. Okay. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
All right. So when there is no forcing in the C and D plane, you can see that inner trajectories move out, outer trajectories move in. There is a unique limit cycle, and that limit cycle is going round clockwise. And this means that the phi is changing steadily and dropping behind as it happens. The phase is dropping behind as it happens.
And how do we know that phi is changing steadily?
It's going in a circle. It's going in a circle. In this case, it need not be at a steady force, but you see, if F is zero, then F is zero, then phi is changing steadily because delta is a constant. Okay. Now, over here, once I start increasing F, I still have a limit cycle. It encloses the origin. Phi may now not be increasing at a constant rate, but it is increasing. Maybe it is increasing like this or something with time, or decreasing in this case, I think, as it happens going clockwise, but maybe minus phi. But what I'm saying is it is going round and round the origin, you see. So it is sweeping around like this. Okay. So phi is not stopping. You agree?
Yes.
Now, same story here. And here is a special value. At this value, what happens is that the limit cycle is still existing, but it passes through the origin. After it passes through the origin, then what happens is for a still bigger value of F, there is still a limit cycle. But now you see phi just oscillates in this range. That means you have weak entrainment. Because the distance from the origin is changing, so amplitude is modulated, but phase is locked to forcing on average.
What is entrainment?
Phase is locked to forcing. Entrained. Entrainment is being caught in some kind of dynamic way.
And what is meant by amplitude is modulated?
Amplitude is modulated means amplitude curve is not constant.
Okay.
So that is what I think entrainment means. Let's take a look. What is entrainment? Coupling of two independent oscillatory systems in such a way that their periods of oscillation become become by virtue of phase alignment. Does that roughly apply here? I hope you think it applies.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Now, here for a larger value of f, what has happened is that limit cycle, this limit cycle we had here, this one, has shrunk to a point. It is some point. Now, basically, what is happening is that the amplitude is also not varying. Phase is also not varying. Phi has gone to a constant. It is not oscillating. So this is strongly locked, which is what we expected for a large forcing. Right? Now let us look at some time series. So here is one point, f is 1.3. It is not yet locked, not entrained. What this means is that, see, this is f sine t, red line is f sine t. Okay? Now you see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, whatever, right? But you see over here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Over here, there is a relatively rapid change in the phase relationship, you see. Here, the blue was behind the red. Here, the blue is ahead of the red in just two oscillations. Moving quite fast, okay? At 1.446, what happens is the amplitude actually goes to zero. And then again, it builds. Then it goes to zero. Then it builds. And why is that? You look here, because the phase portrait
phenomenon
passing through zero. No, not just beating. The limit cycle passes through zero in CD plane. When C is zero and D is zero, amplitude is zero. F is 1.446 from averaging. Here, 1.446. That it will come to zero and show some envelope like this is predicted by averaging. Over here, why is the rate of phase change? You see, from here to here, half a cycle, half a cycle, half a cycle, half a cycle. Amplitude is not changing. The phase is not changing fast. Over here, the phase is changing very fast. Why is that? You come here and you will see 1.3, which is 1.3. Here is 1.3. So now, if you come here and let me use a red pen, when you are close to this, phase is changing fast. When you are far away, phase is changing slowly.
Okay.
So when the amplitude is big, the phase is not changing fast. Over here, the phase will be changing extremely fast. There will be a pi by 2 phase change very rapidly. You come here. You see, there will be a pi by 2 phase change very rapidly. From here to here, you see this was behind by pi by 2?
Yes.
Oh, sorry, pi phase change. It was behind by pi by 2, here it is ahead by pi by 2. Pi phase change, right? From here, that's pi, not pi by 2. And then over here, what is happening? You see, blue is between red and it persists like that. It moves a little bit, but nothing really changes. This is why, because it is weakly entrained. Now the number of zero crossings for blue and red is exactly the same. And over here, for the last value, you see perfectly periodic and locked. Okay, so that's all I have to say. So this is just a discussion of that. We can look at those and we will finish here. Okay, so this part is now over. Entrainment. I told you to read it. You have read it. Now I have shown you and the matter is over. Okay. Now I want to show you something else. So let us say that I have this is called a vertically driven pendulum. Okay?
Okay.
Is it clear? The base is given a small displacement of some kind. Oscillatory.
Vertical displacement.
Vertical displacement. Okay? So, you can, why is the pendulum hanging down? Because of gravity, it has this oscillation. But you could do a similar thing by taking a rod that is cantilevered and giving it a base excitation like this. So if there is some interesting oscillation here, there may be an interesting oscillation in a structure when you're carrying it on a truck and there is a base excitation from the rod. Do you understand?
Yes.
Similar. If this is cantilever and gravity is not important, maybe you're driving at 60, 65 kilometers an hour and there is some something coming from the road and you have a funny resonance. It is similar to this problem. Now let us write equations for this. Okay. So when we write equations, what do? We say this point has an acceleration u double dot, right? This point is, let us say, O. Let's say this point is P. The acceleration of P relative to O is equal to L theta double dot in the E theta direction minus L theta dot square in the ER direction. I hope you agree. This is something that we have done many times. Yes?
Yes, sir.
All right. Therefore, the acceleration of P is equal to the acceleration of P relative to O. This, of course, is the acceleration of O. So, plus the acceleration of O. So, that is equal to U double dot. Let's write here I J, U double dot J plus L theta double dot E theta minus L theta dot square ER. Now let's do a free body diagram. The free body diagram has a tension in the rod and a weight. The free body diagram of just that point mass. You agree?
Yes, sir.
All right. And therefore, I have my linear momentum balance, which is minus T ER minus Mg J is equal to M U double dot J plus L theta double dot E theta minus L theta dot square ER. Okay? This is linear momentum balance. Agreed?
Yes.
All right. What are my unknowns? One is the tension T, the other is theta double dot. The role of the equation of motion, as always, U double dot will be given, theta will be given, theta dot will be given, right? And you have to find the acceleration over here. You also have to find the tension force if you wish to find it. But we don't wish to find it. Our main interest is theta double dot. And this is in the ER direction. So we will take the dot product. We will take a dot product with E theta. And when we do that, the T will go away. Okay? Agreed?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. So this is J. J dotted with E theta, if since this angle is theta, J dotted with E theta is sine theta. You agree? J dotted with E theta is equal to sine theta. So we will come here. When I take the dot product, I'll get minus MG sine theta is equal to M U double dot sine theta plus M L theta double dot. This is the equation of motion. Yes, please.
Sir, okay.
Yes, please. Go ahead.
No, sir, okay.
Okay. So, this is my equation of motion. Now, the M cancels. Right? And I have, let me see now. So, I have theta double dot plus
G sine theta
1 by L G plus U double dot sine theta equals 0. This is the equation for a vertically driven undamped pendulum. Okay, now we G equal to 1, L equal to 1. This is just by choice of time of units, non-dimensionalization, whatever it is. Okay? All right. Can you hear me still?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is because this morning I had a meeting and, you know, my internet connection crashed and I don't know what I was doing and who was recording what, nobody knew. Okay, so we will take that and then U double dot I will take to be epsilon cos 2t for reasons that will be clearer later, but today this is my choice.
Okay.
So, and I will take theta small, which means I will linearize. So I get theta double dot plus 1 plus epsilon cos 2t theta equals 0. This is a special case of something called the Matthew equation, which we will look at. Okay, so this is a special case of the Matthew equation. Why did I choose 2t? That is the important question. The answer is that there is an intuitively clear resonance when it is 2t. Okay, so think of this. This is called parametric forcing. Why is it called parametric forcing? Because the thing multiplying theta is normally something we call it a stiffness. We call it a parameter. But here the parameter is changing externally with time.
Epsilon.
Not epsilon, dependence on t, 2t.
Okay.
This thing in brackets normally would be called a stiffness. It would be a constant. Normal spring mass oscillator, the spring stiffness will come here.
Mm-hmm.
So it's normally a parameter. But here what is happening is that what was earlier normally a parameter is now a function of time.
Okay.
So that is why we are forcing the system by varying the parameter. That is why this type of forcing, where a function of time multiplies the independent variable or multiplies the dynamic variable, such forcing is called parametric forcing. Yes? No difficulty, right? I hope this is just a definition. Okay?
Okay.
Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Sir. All right. Now you think of a child pumping a swing. So here is the child, and the child, what the child does is, you know, it sort of moves up and down relative to the swing. Okay. And over there, what is the child doing? Effectively changing the length of the swing, length of the pendulum. You see, the simplest model is that the child is changing the length of the pendulum.
Yes, sir.
At what frequency? One kick here, then one kick here. That means twice per cycle. Twice per cycle. That is why I am doing 2T over here. Okay. I know that twice per cycle is a powerful form of excitation when you want parametric resonance.
Sir, he is raising the leg once on the right and means...
Let us say the child is standing on the swing, then sitting down once and standing up here, then sitting down once and standing up here. So that this is one blip on the forcing, this is one blip on the forcing, twice per cycle.
Means if he stood up on the right, then he will go to the left standing and then he will sit down on the left. And
no,
come
he
back
doesn't
to the
right. Do that. If you say okay. That, then you may not have played on a swing. If you played on a swing as a child, then you will know. See, what you are talking about is different. You know, when they are going this way and they are sitting, they'll raise their leg like this.
Yes, sir.
They'll go like this. Then when they are coming back, they will fold the leg back.
Pull, and, yes.
Yes, that is a different way of doing it. But there is a way of standing on swings. If you see a children doing, then what they will do is they will sit and stand quickly at this end of the swing. Then they will sit and stand quickly at
okay.
this end of the swing.
Yes, sir.
Have you seen yes, that?
I remember.
Okay, very good. Even I remember. I haven't done it for many years. Okay. All right. So now for this parametric forcing, let us now move to MATLAB and see what is happening. And I will add some terms. So because I am forcing externally at 2T, I will add a plus epsilon delta theta because my forcing frequency may not be exactly correct. And I will add a plus epsilon c theta dot for some small damping. Is that okay? I'll add these terms, but otherwise I will look at this linear system near the 2 to 1 resonance with weak parametric forcing, small detuning and small damping. Clear?
Sir, but there is no forcing term in the equation here.
This is the forcing. It is parametric forcing.
Oh, okay.
So theta double dot plus epsilon c theta dot plus theta plus epsilon delta x. Delta is the detuning parameter. Plus epsilon cos 2t theta. I'm sorry, this is also theta.
Okay, so the forcing depends
on... This is damping, this is detuning, this is parametric forcing.
Okay, sir.
Forcing is there. What I want you to notice is that theta equals 0 is the solution. But it can be unstable, then it will grow. Okay?
Yes.
All right. Let's go to MATLAB. So here, epsilon I have taken to be 0.05. Let me first put C is equal to 0. That means there is no damping. Let me put delta equal to 0. Doesn't matter. That means there is no detuning. I'm writing the system in first order form. Q dot is equal to Q2 epsilon C into Q2. Anyway, damping is not there. Minus Q1, that is the X term. Minus epsilon delta Q1, that is the epsilon delta X term. Minus epsilon cos 2T into Q1, that is the parametric forcing. Clear so far?
Yes, sir.
All right. Let's see what happens to the solution when I start it from some small non-zero condition. Here is the solution. And you can see that it is basically exponentially growing. That is because it's a linear system. I've linearized it. With nonlinear terms, it may have saturated somewhere, but here it is just linearly growing. Clear so far? Is it in fact exponentially growing? We can see that easily by doing semi log y. So it will ignore the negative data, but you can see this part is a straight line. Yes?
Yes, sir.
That means it is growing exponentially.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we have seen that. Now, what we will do is we will look at other solutions using averaging. So we'll come here now. We are all familiar with experts with averaging. So over here, x I will say is a sine t plus phi, and v, which is x dot, is a cos t plus phi. Then here is my differential equation. Here I have kept x, epsilon delta x, epsilon cos 2t x, and epsilon c x dot. I've kept them all. Here is my first equation from averaging, right? Which is that the derivative of this must be equal to that. So the derivative of this left side is, you know, the derivative with respect to a into a dot, plus the derivative with respect to phi into phi dot, plus the derivative with respect to time is equal to x dot. Okay, so that's one equation. The other equation is I am substituting the x double dot term by taking the derivative of this x ds, taking the derivative of that, and I'm putting that into the x double dot. After I do that, then I'm putting in the x dot. After I do that, I'm putting in the x. Okay, then I'm saying take this e1 and this final e2 and solve for a dot and phi dot. Then after that, I'm pulling out the a dot term and taking the time period to be 2 pi, because it has a bunch of terms. The actual time period may be different, but 2 pi is good enough. Okay, so I take 2 pi, I get that's a dot and that's phi dot. The a dot part, we have to think about a bit. We will do it later. This phi dot part, I can do combined trig and I get something here. So this is my first observation. So here is a dot and here is phi dot, right? So I hope you will agree that compared to this equation, which we did not know how to solve, if epsilon is small, we have made actually very substantial progress because we have much simpler equations. Do you agree?
Yes, sir.
All right. Separately, in the previous, you know, Van der Poel, when we did that, what we found is a dot was a function of a but not of phi. And phi dot was just some constant or a function of a or something. Thus, averaged slow flow did not depend on phi. Why? I told you it is because it was an autonomous system. There was no external clock. But now it is a non-autonomous system. There is an external clock. There is a cos 2t forcing. You agree? Because there is a cos 2t forcing, therefore the phase of the oscillation is important. And that is why the slow flow turns out that there is a phase in the oscillation. Clear so far?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now this is phi dot. The phi dot equation has almost all our understanding in it. Okay. So let me show you. I will go back to my drawing. The epsilon part is not important. As I have said, that just sort of determines a slow rate. So it is minus cos 2 phi by 4 plus delta by 2. That's the phi dot equation. Phi dot is minus cos 2 phi by 4 plus delta by 2. Even this, I hope you will not mind if I just say, really this 4 also is not important, right? So what we really need, because there was an epsilon there, right? So what we really need is to look at minus cos 2 phi plus 2 delta. Do you agree?
Yes.
Okay. Let us look at this graph here. See, because now the phi and phi dot, see how beautifully it has separated, right? So now let me draw, if delta is zero, then this is, cos 2 phi, right?
Yes, sir.
But then plus 2 delta means something. We will see that soon enough. Now, what is the dynamics? Over here, phi dot is positive. That means it will go like this. Over here, phi dot is negative. That means it will go like this. Over here, phi dot is positive. It will go like this. Over here, phi dot is negative. So, it will go like this and so on. Yes, you see the dynamics. So, this is stable. This is stable. And this is unstable. This is unstable. Right? So basically, we are looking at something like this over here. It is going to stabilize at this point, or phi is going to stabilize at 2 phi is going to be minus pi by 2. 2 phi is equal to minus pi by 2. Phi is equal to minus pi by 4. So it may stabilize here. Do you agree?
Yes.
And what is this? This is just 2 pi minus pi by 4. So it is the same as pi minus pi by 4. So then, pi minus pi by 4. It's okay. We'll look at that. That's interesting. I thought it will be the same. We will make sure. Okay. So either phi will be minus pi by 4. Otherwise, what is this now? 2 phi is equal to pi plus pi by 2. Pi minus pi by 4. Is that okay? Okay, so these are a couple of solutions. Now let us look at the A equation. The A equation, for the moment, let me put C is equal to 0. Okay? It doesn't matter. This is the part that is important. Sin phi cos phi. So what is sin phi cos phi? Sin phi cos phi is equal to, in this case, minus half. Agreed? That's not difficult. Sir. You should agree. Yes?
Yes, sir, sir.
And in this case, minus half.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So therefore, what is happening here is that this is just minus half. That means that minus will come here and become plus. You see? So what will happen is A dot is equal to minus epsilon A by 2 C minus half. Of course, this corresponds to delta equals 0, okay?
Okay.
This is the steady state behavior. Phi will rapidly saturate to that point, and then this is what will remain. Okay.
Yes, sir.
So if C is less than half, then A dot is, you know, some K times A, K greater than zero. So amplitude will grow. And if C is more than half, then amplitude will decay.
Yes, sir.
This is the prediction of averaging. Okay, let us come here and look. Delta is 0. C is 0.4. Theory predicts solution will grow. It's growing. C is 0.6. Theory predicts solution will decay. decay. Initially slightly faster because there is a transient in phi also. This is the steady period behavior with phi. Okay.
Then you can answer last
thing. You have to move. Yeah, tell me.
Last thing, what you told, transient part.
See, initially it is faster. This exponential rate is something. This is a little bit faster.
Okay. Why is that?
That is because that phi has not yet settled to a steady value.
Okay.
See, initially there is a bit of a transient here. Then after that, exponential.
Okay.
So this transient is while phi is not yet settled. The phase is still evolving.
So it should, means the transient is also looking like a linear on the semi-log plot.
No, it's not. If you look here,
Achha.
You see, this is the linear part, but over here some other rate is there. Something else is happening. That to do that, we have to solve the double system. We have to solve A and phi both. But I am just showing you that even just by looking at the phi equation separately and understanding the behavior, I can say something about how the amplitude will decay steadily. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right. Now we will come back here to this equation. You see, now there is a plus 2 delta. So with a plus 2 delta, what will happen is this curve will now be like this. And then what happens is this is the new equilibrium, but it is still stable. This is unstable, this is stable, and so on.
Yes, sir.
Right?
Yes,
it
sir.
Only becomes interesting when delta is more than half.
No stable solution.
When delta is more than half, then what happens is that the phi dot graph looks like this. So it slows down, then speeds up, then slows down, then speeds up. Okay? But it keeps going. This is phi dot and this is phi. So if delta is more than half, then phi does not settle down. Then you come to A, even if C is zero, see I have A dot is equal to minus epsilon A by 2 C. First, sine phi, cos phi, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So what will happen is I expect when C is not there, when C is not there, there is this A dot, you know, I expect it to sort of to keep going up and down because sine phi and cos phi will keep changing and it will be negative and positive. There should be a modulated solution. So let us do that. Let us try delta more than half and C equal to zero. So let's come here now and say delta equal to 0.6 and C equals zero. So theory makes me expect a modulated solution in amplitude. But remember, I'm not solving the averaged equation. I'm solving the original differential equation. Okay?
Yes, sir.
All right, let's take a look. You see, there is a modulated amplitude solution. Okay? But of course, the real system will have damping. When it has damping and we put a small damping here, then the average of the sine phi cos phi, which looked like it was zero earlier, although I have not proved that, but it looked like it was zero earlier, right? So then with delta equal to zero, then over here, see, I put non-zero, then what happens is there is a damping, but there is a modulation around it. So if I come here, if I put C is equal to 0.1, then I will get decay, but it will be a modulated decay. You see, modulated decay. when I do semi-log, you see it's modulated, but there is this exponential decay rate on average. This is from the time series simulation, right? It is not from averaging. Averaging is predicting this.
Yes, yes.
Okay. So now if we go back here, you see now if I put some delta also, what will happen? When I put some delta, this phi will just go to some other value. But if delta is very big, phi will not settle down, then it will be something. When I put delta less than half, then what will happen is phi will settle at some value. And then at that value, this may increase or decrease. Even in the worst case, if c is more than half, it will decay. That's all. Right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So these are the things that we have found. The simplest case is like this. So remember, x double dot plus epsilon delta x plus epsilon c x dot plus epsilon cos 2t x equals 0. Okay. Now, what I will show here is over here I will plot epsilon, and this is a very bad way to do it. I don't want to do it like this. I'm sorry. It will be confusing, but let me not do that. My point is, if this is not there, in that case, unstable for absolute value of delta less than half. So I did not do a negative value. Let me do that and show you. So let me put the damping to be 0, and let me put delta equals minus 0.3. Yeah, unstable. Doesn't matter. That is the amount of detuning it can tolerate, is 0.5. It's unstable. Okay, so that ends my discussion of the second system, which we have studied with the first order averaging. With your permission, I'll tell you something else that is very interesting about this 2-to-1 resonance. So, you know, suppose you have a ship. So let's say you have a ship like this. And it's going in water, right? So there's water here. The ship is in water and the ship is moving forward like this. Okay. Now let us say that there are waves coming like this. So when there is a long wave like this along the length of the ship, right? So what happens is it affects the buoyancy forces, buoyancy torques encountered by the ship when it has a roll oscillation. Do you understand this part? Are you still there?
Can you explain again?
So a ship has a roll oscillation, right? So if I look at the ship from the back, here is the ship. It's in water. Suppose I tilt the ship like this. Well, not that much, then it'll sink. But if I tilt the ship like this and release it, then the ship will oscillate like this about some axis here. It will oscillate like this. It's called a roll oscillation.
Okay.
How many of you have heard of roll, pitch and yaw?
Yes, sir. I have heard.
So this longitudinal axis of the ship, this is the roll axis. This vertical axis, this is the yaw axis. And this forward going up and down, this is the pitch. So if there are waves coming like this and the boat is going up and down, so the nose is going up and then coming down and going up and coming down. This is called pitching.
Yes, sir.
And when the ship is rolling from side to side, oscillating from side to side, that is rolling. Okay?
Okay.
So if you have a very long ship, then the pitching will not be much, but it can still be rolling. So seasickness in ships will be because of rolling. But also if you have containers on the ship, it is a container ship, they are tied with chains and so on. If you have a very big roll oscillation, then it can break the chain and the container can fall into the sea. If there are people over there, they can be very badly injured or killed.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So now, what is the roll oscillation of the ship? The roll oscillation of the ship depends on the moment of inertia of the ship and the restoring torque from the buoyancy forces. Okay. The restoring torque from the buoyancy forces when the water is perfectly flat is something, and that determines the roll oscillation of the ship. But when there are waves, long waves coming like this, in that case, you see the height of the water on the side of the ship is not constant. It is high somewhere, low somewhere, high somewhere, low somewhere, because of this wave that is existing. The ship is quite long, right? It may cover one wave, one and a half waves. Right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So when that happens...
Are the waves coming from the pitch direction or roll direction?
They are forward waves. So they are coming from the pitch direction. The waves are causing a small pitch oscillation, but not very big. What is happening is that the roll restoring torque is changing because the depth of water that the ship in is different.
If the wave is from the pitch side.
One second. This is from the office. Shobhit. Baad mein phone karta hoon, bada raha. So, this is the ship. I don't know how else to draw it. This is the ship. I'm showing in yellow now, right?
Yeah.
Now, along the length of the ship, there is a water line. This is the water line. So over here, in the back view of the ship, this is the water line. Okay? This is the roll axis of the ship. If I disturb the ship slightly like this, it will oscillate. It will rotate about this axis. When I disturb it by a small angle theta, it will, due to buoyancy forces in the water and asymmetry in the hull shape and so on, it will get a restoring torque kt theta. And that will be in balance with the polar moment of inertia of the ship to give you an oscillator and a roll frequency.
Yes.
Okay. But now suppose there are waves coming, so that now I will draw this in magenta. So now suppose that the water line is not constant along the length of the ship. Then it will change KT. Right?
Yes.
You change it in some way. It may decrease it or it may increase it. Who cares? We'll change it, no? And its average value will still be the old value. Then as the waves are passing, depending on where the crest of this wave is, whether it is here or whether it is here or whether it is here, it will be changing. KT will be changing as a function of time.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So then what will happen is your equation will be JP theta double dot plus KT zero plus some delta.
It's a function of space.
It is a function of space because the ship is moving forward. Oh.
Yes.
But for the roll oscillation purpose, it is just a function of time. And so this is going to be some K tilde cos T or cos omega T theta dot. Sorry, theta is equal to zero. So this is like the ship. Now you see what is interesting is that these waves have a certain length and they are moving with a certain velocity, but your ship has a forward velocity which can change. So for certain value of forward velocity, the wave encounter frequency can become 2 times the roll oscillation frequency.
Oh.
When that happens, you get the same resonance. So in Kharagpur, there is a CA. Center for, well, you know, the old Naval Architecture Department. Naval Architecture and Ocean Engineering, I think it is called now or something. But in Kharagpur, in IIT Kharagpur, there's a Naval Architecture Department. And over there, one of my friends in the faculty, he was telling me that one of their students who serves on a computer container ship said that they knew it is there, but they did not understand that it is so clearly 2:1. So he was on a container ship when it actually had this resonance, and the roll angle was 30 degrees and containers broke chains and fell into the water. So it does happen. It can happen, right? You can ship something in a vehicle and it may arrive damaged because of some funny resonance. You have accelerometers. You find that you never hit a structural resonance apparently, and yet it vibrated. It can happen, right? So the 2:1 resonance is actually quite powerful. The strongest is 1:1. Excitation frequency and response frequency are the same, but in parametric forcing, the 2:1 frequency is the strongest one. Okay, so we'll stop now. Can I stop recording, please? Yes? Or you have a question? No question?
Yes, sir. You can stop.
All right. Thank you.